Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. And for all of you joining us via live stream, we are so excited that we can have these in two places at the same time. My name is Claudia Williams. I am the Director of Membership and Development at Grantmakers for Effective Organizations. This program today is something that we really like at the GEO conference. The audience really loves it. It's a short talk where we have a thought leader presenting provoking and interesting ideas and perspectives to challenge our thinking. We will have three rounds of speakers. The first two rounds will have three speakers, and the last round will have only two speakers. You can find on your app all of the descriptions for the session as well as locations. And we recommend that you take a look at the app and map your choices in case you wanna change rooms or go catch up another talk. We will have about 20 minutes, and then we will have a very short time for questions and answers. But if you don't have a chance to ask your question today, we encourage you that you use the app to connect with Nabiha, and she will also be here at the end in between sessions. So you can also connect with her afterwards. And finally, we as a learning organization are very interested in your feedback. So at the end of the session, please take a moment to open the app and share some thoughts with us about the session. And now, without any further ado, please welcome Nabiha Syed. She is the president and CEO of the Markup, an award-winning journalism nonprofit that challenges technology to serve the public good. And she's also a fellow at the Yale School, where she teaches on the First Amendment. Thank you, everyone.
Good morning, everybody. So I'm gonna talk about my two favorite vowels, A and I, this morning. It's the only vowels anyone seems to remember in the last year. So who here has heard people say, oh, AI, this is a doomsday situation. It's lights out for us, it's not good. Who's heard that? Okay. Who believes that? It's okay. Safe space, guys, safe space. Who's heard people say, AI, this is gonna solve all of our problems? Like, this is it, this is great, A plus, we don't have to do anything, the robots will do the work and we'll be on a beach. Some of you have heard that. You've heard the hype, you've heard the optimism. Who believes that? Again, safe space. Okay, so what we're gonna do in the next 20 minutes is that I am going to tell you a story, a doomsday story, about the use of AI. I'm gonna tell you a really optimistic story. And then what we're gonna discuss is what that third, more realistic application of the technology could look like. And we're gonna structure that around five questions I think you should be asking yourselves if you are thinking about implementing AI in your own organization, or if you're working with grantees or other people in your community who are also kind of thinking, do I have to be using ChatGPT for everything, or should I be throwing, like, office spacing my computer, like, out of the window onto the floor? So let's begin with story. A 41-year-old woman named Imani Abu Slamain came home from the hospital in Rotterdam, the Netherlands, and she'd been in the hospital for about 10 days for a minor procedure, comes home and checks her mail. Gets her mail, puts it all down on her kitchen table, opens up an envelope that says, "You have been accused by the Dutch government of benefits fraud. Please show up to the social services office at this time in 1 week with your evidence proving that you have not committed benefits fraud." I don't know if any of you have had to prove a negative. As a person who spent a decade as a defense lawyer, I can tell you it's not great. And Imani looks at this and says, okay, I don't know what I did. I don't know any details, but I'm gonna bring my receipts from the part-time job I have, my sort of pay stubs, I'm gonna bring any receipts I can find, I'm gonna bring all of this to the social services office and show them that I haven't committed benefits fraud. And she shows up and they sort of rifle through her papers and they say, sorry, you have 15 more days to prove that you have not committed benefits fraud because you've been accused. She has no details on the accusation, no details at all. And if you don't, you'll be removed off of all of your healthcare benefits. And so she goes and she speaks to a social worker and she starts speaking in her neighborhood and people are like, yeah, we've heard of this happening. We've heard of people receiving letters that they've been accused of childcare benefits fraud and healthcare benefits fraud. And no one knows where this is coming from. So Amani loses her benefits. She ends up moving in with one of her sons. Her other younger son leaves school to start getting a job to pay back the fines for the alleged fraud. And Imani, and as it turns out, 8,000 other women like her had been flagged by an algorithm that had decided that she was at high risk of committing fraud. The algorithm was indexed on a variety of different factors, but there were two factors that were relevant in making this flag an ultimate decision about her. One, that she was a mother, and second, that she didn't speak Dutch. She was a foreigner. So the worst stereotype of a welfare queen had been encoded into this algorithm, used to flag thousands of women, and resulted in people becoming homeless, taking out loans to pay their fines, having their family members and their children quit going to school to start working. And no one knew about it because everyone was suffering in silence until social workers started speaking to one another to say, where are these letters coming from? What's going on here? A couple of them start talking to reporters. Reporters are like, that's strange. What's going on? They start digging in. They start filing public records requests. They end up figuring out that this was an algorithm provided by a vendor to the city of Rotterdam that was algorithmically flagging all of these women for fraud. And it ruined lives. The good news about this is that once it came to light, the EU Parliament actually had an historic fine against the government and said, you need to interrogate your algorithms and your systems to make sure that they are not having this sort of disparate impact on people. You need to make these models more transparent. We need to understand the input data that's going into them. And now we're standing at the precipice of sort of landmark EU legislation around algorithmic accountability and AI. But this is, oop, this is not what you're looking at. What you're looking at is this. This is an example of predictive AI going entirely rogue and not in the doomsday Terminator, like HAL sort of way that people fantasize about. In this very simple, dumb algorithm encoded with racial bias that did in fact ruin people's lives. So when people talk about how AI might be a doomsday scenario, the reality is that for some people it is. And it already has been for years. My organization, The Markup, that we launched about 4 years ago, actually uses machine learning and AI to hold technology systems to account. So we sit in this sort of interesting position where we have all of these technologists, we have data scientists, we have statisticians, who are pairing up with folks in the grassroots, folks in communities, to say, hey, when you think this weird thing is happening, call us, we'll dig into it. And the truth is these harms are invisible. People see that something is happening, they don't know how to point to the larger phenomenon, the larger structures that are making this happen. And in order to actually decipher those, you need a level of skill and talent that is expensive and hard to get. So the doomsday is possible with a type of AI that's been here for years, not even the sort of generative AI chat GPT that burst into our consciousness 18 months ago. Now I want to tell you a story that's a little bit more optimistic than that deeply disturbing horror show. Who here works in environmental justice or works with partners that do? So for folks of you who are in and adjacent to those fields or even care about it, you might know that illegal mining is a really big problem throughout the world. Illegal mining is a huge problem in the Amazon rainforest. Now, illegal mining is an environmental problem, of course, because you have often people with very little care for the environment showing up, drilling, extracting resources from the ground, and causing a lot of damage, particularly the livelihoods of indigenous communities who are around them. It's also a problem for a lot of governments because non-state actors who are sometimes using these extracted materials to fund unsavory activities are adding an additional layer of harm to communities on top of the environmental harm that's happening. But how do you find an illegal mine? You could like walk around the Amazon rainforest and be like, that looks bad. Someone should call the police. That would not be effective, efficient, or a plan for longevity. Like, that's not a good plan, right? So how do you find illegal mines? You know, once you hear about it from a local community, the harm has been done, right? The harm has been done to the land. So environmental justice activists in the Amazon teamed up with reporters to say, how could we investigate this and understand, one, how prevalent the problem is, and maybe try to intervene a little bit faster before we ultimately hear about the harm. These journalists ended up calling in some computer scientists, and they sat down and they thought, okay, how could we figure out where illegal mines are? If you set up an illegal mine, you need some way to remove the extracted resources. That could be trucks that go on roads. It could also be in planes that require an airstrip. Airstrips and roads are visible in satellite imagery. If you have enough satellite imagery, could you train a machine learning model to ingest a large amount of satellite imagery and in real time start flagging for you where mining operations are taking place? That is exactly what this team of reporters ended up doing in Brazil. They found that there were 672 more illegal mines than the mines that were properly registered in a particular area. They co-published this article and deep investigation with the New York Times, as well as in local outlets in Brazil and also in television. It ended up becoming a huge, huge issue for their elections and resulted in a landmark set of prosecutions against people who were doing this kind of mining. How were they able to do it? A machine learning model that figured out this is what it looks like. This is what roads and airstrips look like in the sky. This is an incredible model for taking a problem that people had identified, adding to it machine learning, a form of AI, to understand what was going on with real benefits on the ground, right? So this is an example of AI actually doing something a little bit more important than just helping you write an email, right? This is like actually solving some big harms. So you'll see people who are like touting sort of AI for good, tech for good, using examples like this. And then also other people who are really focused on this kind of example. And the question is, okay, great, this is all happening, but also every single day I'm getting new headlines pushed to me saying, there's a new version of ChatGPT, you should be using AI. If you don't use it, you'll be left behind. How do you make sense of these two different universes, right? Like, what do? I did this chat with Bridgespan, and we had a lot about AI and how to adopt AI into your systems. And so many people showed up just saying, should we just be experimenting with ChatGPT or any of these variety, you know, Midjourney for image generation, all these other things. We're being told we should just experiment with it. We should just jump in with both feet. We don't want to be left behind, right? We don't want to be left behind in this technological revolution. And what I want to offer to you is just five questions that you should be thinking about as you integrate or decide whether you want to actually use this kind of technology into your work. So the first question is a deceptively simple one. What are you solving for? You will see a lot of advice that says, just plunge in, just use it, just get it. And I would actually recommend something like the thought process that happened in that Amazon example of identifying what the pain points are. What's actually taking a lot of time in your organization or with people that you work with? What's a problem that they want to solve? Is it something that a variety of these different technologies, because it's a much bigger universe than ChatGPT, is there something where automation can help you, right? Because once you answer that question of what is the problem and can automation help you, then you can start to think about whether you actually have the right data to do this work, whether your organization is digitally mature enough to be able to do that, whether you are investing in skills like data literacy, problem solving, sort of collaborative decision making, and whether you have those skills in your organization, and then that can start to give you an actual meaningful roadmap. What is the problem? What is the data I need to actually solve this, right? Which in the example of the airstrips was like satellite imagery. Like, what do you actually need? And how can you go forward? An incredible group called Charter, which does a lot of work for effective management of like nonprofits and mission-oriented places, did this great report on how to adapt AI. And its biggest observation from organizations had been that self-reported that they felt like they were doing a good job in adapting AI into their systems. So that actually the best innovations come from not the special working committees of the C-suite thinking about AI. It comes from the people who are on the front lines of the work, identifying what the problems are, what pain points are. People who really know how your business works, how your organization works, what needs you're solving for. This is, unlike a lot of other tech innovation or transformative moments, is going to be a bottom-up innovation moment, which is really powerful to think about. But you have to make sure that everyone actually has the skills and capabilities to be able to embrace this innovation, this moment. Second question is, who might get hurt? What we saw in the first Rotterdam example is that there's a reasonable desire for a government to say, hey, you know, we want to cut down on fraud. We only have so much money. There's not enough to go around. We want to make sure that people aren't availing themselves of a resource when they don't actually need it. But what they didn't do sufficiently was what's called an impact assessment. They didn't do a fulsome look at who could this hurt if we're using these particular markers like being a mother or not speaking Dutch? What are the implications of this? And this is a really big problem that in the Markup's work we've seen time and time and time again. We did a set of investigations around predictive algorithms being deployed in school systems. Very noble intention of flagging students who might be at high risk of failing. But the problem is that they would flag these students and use factors like whether you were getting a reduced or free lunch and what your race was, and then sending letters to people's parents saying, your child has been flagged at high risk of failing out of high school. The end. No intervention, no benefits, hey, here's a resource, no training, no nothing. So the harm that was being perpetuated there, the hurt, was actually now hurting children's self-esteem because their parents are saying, why are you going to fail out of school? And they're like, I don't know, right? So this question about who might get hurt is worth thinking about in a pretty robust way. In the EU and some state jurisdictions, including California, impact assessments for the widespread deployment of predictive systems and AI systems is actually required at a certain threshold in certain sectors. It's not really required for you if you were to, you know, decide to start using AI tomorrow, but I would encourage you to think of it as a necessary requirement, right? Think about who you're impacting and how. And in the literature around trustworthy and ethical AI, this concept of fairness, right, of like, how are we thinking about fairness and are we baking it from day one is a pretty important principle. And I would say an impact assessment and a really robust understanding of who are the potential people that might get hurt is something you should do before you implement any system. The third is, how can you evaluate? This feels for so many organizations that we've spoken to at the Markup through our actual investigations or just people who are curious about how we do our work, the evaluation set of questions is something that comes up way downstream, right? It's like, let's deploy it, let's get it out there, let's figure out what the evaluation looks like. No, you need to be thinking about what evaluation looks like upfront because it has a lot of implications for the data you decide to use, the transparency measures you have in place, what teams are participating in the evaluation versus the people who are actually deploying it. This is actually like an organizational set of questions. And this is how you get to real meaningful accountability, whether this is a set of questions of evaluating government programs or just your use internally to make you more efficient in reaching certain communities. The fourth is, how do you bake in safety also from day one? And this is where I would say the resources that are available right now are actually fairly decent in terms of thinking about, do we actually run algorithmic decision making on data sets that have personal information? private information? How do we think about cybersecurity, right? How do we think about evaluating the services, the vendors, the people who are coming to us saying we use AI for these kinds of recommendations? There are a lot of checklists, AI policies, and other resources that are out there that are actually pretty good. And if folks want direction to them, come talk to me afterwards. I'm happy to help direct to resources. But this sort of, how do you think about the policies and the data use practices? This is an area where there's good existing resource that you can use to guide your initial application. It's just something, again, that like you can't retrofit later, especially because I presume most organizations aren't cooking up their own AI that they'll be using. You will be relying on vendors and other third-party services. And actually, on the third-party services front, just like a little mini example of how much it matters. At the Markup, we did a big investigation into the Facebook pixel. Who knows about the Facebook pixel? Okay, some folks do. Anytime you put the little like us on Facebook, F, on a web page, what it does is it opens the door for Facebook, not only for people to click it and go like you on Facebook. This is a two-way door. Facebook is collecting data from that page too. And so in a set of investigations that we did, we revealed that when people are filling out tax prep information on H&R Block or going to the Mayo Clinic and saying, I have a migraine, I need a doctor within 5 miles of me, the information that's being transmitted there is not just going to the website that you think it's going to. It's not just going to the Mayo Clinic. It's not just going to H&R Block. Facebook is actually intercepting that data and collecting it. Yep. So as a result of our investigations, there's now over 200 class action lawsuits that have been filed. Elizabeth Warren had a set of hearings about it. What was so fascinating to me is that in the hearings and the aftermath around the Facebook pixel work that we did, there were so many organizations that were like, we didn't know that that was the trade. We just thought it said like us on Facebook. Like we didn't know that what it was doing was engaging in a massive practice of data extraction. This is the importance of understanding your vendors, right? This is the importance of understanding the services that you use. Yeah, sure, that's what Meta did, but there are going to be, especially so many people in the AI boom are trying to spin up companies so they can just have an opportunity to make some quick cash. There are going to be disgusting data practices that happen that are extractive that might put populations you work with at risk. And you have to be really thoughtful about what you're doing before you just decide to have fun and experiment. The last question that I think to me is the big one and is the reason that I'm about to start a new job as the executive director of the Mozilla Foundation is who gets to participate? Who gets to participate in this new frontier of the future? Is it women like Imani Abu Sleiman? No one asked her if it was fair for an algorithm to flag her for benefits fraud or not. She didn't have anyone that she could call to say, hey, I think this weird thing is happening and I want some redressability or accountability. Like, I want someone to look into this. These systems of what accountability looks like for our use of this technology are not here. It's not like, oh, I'm just not going to use Facebook, or I'm not going to use that product, or I'm going to vote for someone different in the election. There are not existing accountability structures that are here, and that's a really big problem, especially when we think that so many communities that we care about are affected by the digital divide. They're literally not, right? There's no way to speak up, so tech is being used on you, about you, with none of your input. You might not even have access to a lot of this innovation, so you don't even have fluency in like what's happening and how is it being used. You don't have awareness. And what that can also mean is that because of the digital divide and other disparities, you don't have representation in the data either. So the data that's being used to make analyses doesn't always have information about people of color. And the ethical questions that surround that are enormous, and this is the last thing I'll say before we can maybe take a question or two, is do folks know the work of Dr. Joy Boulamwini? If you don't, you absolutely should, from the Algorithmic Justice League. It is an incredible resource. Her earliest research was around disparity of Black faces in facial recognition software. So really, literally could not tell two Black people apart. Companies responded by saying, that's just fine. We'll get more pictures of Black people and we'll feed it in. Wait a minute. Do you want to be in those data sets? and which is a question, right? Do you want to be represented in those data sets? Do you not want to be represented in those data sets? How should we be thinking about the deployment of data sets that we know are incomplete? And who am I to decide? Who's Chuck Schumer to decide? Who's a company to decide without the say of the people who are actually being affected? And so thinking about the questions of participation are ones that matter for companies, but also for you, because the law is sadly, and I can talk about this afterwards, the law is not there yet. The law is not, in the United States, the law is not mandating inclusion, participation, robustness of data sets. So it's gonna be on you to think about it while we figure out what the biggest strategy is. And so I would just encourage you to like really, really center this question, who gets to participate, not just in your org, but in the data you choose to use. So thanks, everybody. I'm happy to take some questions if we have, oh, no, time? Okay, we have time for a couple of questions maybe, and then, or there's a, we're at time, we're very much at time, but we have 10 minutes, because I talk too much, but we have like 10 minutes until the next.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, so I'll just hang around. I'm very easy to find. I look like a highlighter. I'm happy to answer questions that you have. Thanks, folks.
Thank you so much, everyone. Please take a minute to evaluate the session at the conference app.